Well, welcome. Welcome to everybody. Just a bit of a note. You'll notice that we're getting closer to a 12-hour day of sunshine and a 12-hour day of darkness, which is kind of the beginning of my favorite time of year, spring. And it's time for flowers to start coming out, and it's hopefully time for us to start opening up and coming out from this. We were talking about it's almost an anniversary of the COVID situation, and I'm reminded of the flowers like Master Kuang's lotus she has as her screenshot. You know, if you look around, we need to be spending more time outside. And if you'll notice, the daffodils are blooming, and I've seen a lot of tulips blooming as of late. And so spring has sprung here in Georgia. And we're supposed to be outside. We as cultivators should be spending time outside so that we can become grounded with the earth and appreciate it. Appreciate its bounty, it being a source rather than a resource. A source is something that we can not only appreciate but respect, rather than it being a resource which we can destroy or abuse. And I think it's been all too long that too many of us have been not appreciating that value in, as we are given this gift of life and the bounty. So anyway, that's my message for today. I'm going to briefly ask Aram to perform a second duty today, which is to talk briefly about the technical stuff.
You mean my primary duty?
Well, not today.
Everyone keep your videos and devices muted and videos turned off. If you need to make any comment, please turn on your video so we can give you allow you to make your comment, and at that point, once you're done, you can turn it off and go to mute mode again. Wanted to let you know, guys, we are recording this class, so you should be aware of that. We are creating our Tao Te Ching library, so this class will be part of that. Don't try to chat during the class or screen share or try to click unnecessary buttons. Everyone is doing good. That's all from my side, Roger.
Thanks, Sarah. Last week... if you were participated with us, we had three technical things that happened, one with Barbara, one with myself, and I think one with Master Kuang. And what I thought was the learning and why I want to bring it up is that all three of us seemed very cool and calm and got back on the Skype. I left my computer off and just went to my phone. So if anybody has any problems and they have the option of using their computer and or their phone, just switch over if you're having problem with one, and hopefully you can rejoin the class. I just wanted to bring that up. I was quite pleased with the way that it was fluid, even with those technical issues. A lot of people would not have necessarily been so fluid in getting back on track. So thank you all for that. Our speaker tonight on chapter 3 of the Tao Te Ching and chapter 62, I'm checking just to be absolutely sure, I believe it's 62.
You're right.
Yeah, 62 is our sister Aram. And Aram, when she first came to the temple, her daughter, you know, I always like to tell the story, her daughter brought her, or actually they came together, but I think her daughter was really the driving element, even though they both came to find out what the temple was all about. And even though Aram's daughter hasn't been participative, she's been extremely supportive and encouraging to her mom, to Aram. And Aram has been extremely dedicated to her own cultivation, which has been, you know, as we sit from a perspective of now to not that long ago, and we can see things in ourselves and we can see things in other people that have, through cultivation and through commitment and responsibility, have brought about such a positive change in that person and in the effect that it has on other people, it's really a joy. And this is all I'm going to say about Aram right now. There are many other things I could say, but it's been a joy and a privilege. And for her, having this opportunity is a privilege that we can all help enjoy as well. So having said all that, I'm sorry, Aram, I said that. I didn't wish to offend you or embarrass you, but I feel that way. I feel that way about me. I feel that way. Thank you. Aram, please.
No, you didn't offend me. That's actually the truth. I mean, we feel like the way we are, we always been, but it's always transformation. And it's good to see the change in everyone. And we always changing, and we are changing for good and for positive. If it's going towards that direction, then it's great for all of us. Good evening, everyone. Now I'm going to formally start. Before I begin, I would like to give thanks to the grace of God. Thanks to the great mercy of Miller Buddha. Thanks for the great virtue of Shizu and Shimu. Thanks for the protection of Bai Sui San Ti Wen Si Bodhisattva. Thanks for our Point Master Kuang, Point Master Si, who are watching over us from heaven now. Thanks for our Point Master Jiang and all the Point Masters from Taiwan and their dedication and their support. Thanks for our very own Point Master Tong, Point Master Chang, and Point Master Kuang for their encouragement and support. Thanks for my introducer, my guarantor, and thanks for all of you being here tonight via Skype. I really appreciate you all. Today, as Roger said, I've been given the opportunity to cover another two chapters from Tao Te Ching by Lao Tzu. I'll cover chapter number 3 and chapter number 62. Please keep your books in front of you or whatever translation you have that will come handy. Overview of these two chapters. Chapter 3 is actually all about minding life's fundamental needs. If you do that, then it will lead you to a life of contentment. And chapter 62 points out that there is no greater treasure than spiritual liberation, Tao. Without further ado, I will jump into chapter 3. Chapter 3, as I said, is all about minding your fundamental needs and going with the flow. So when you detach from the mundane, when you detach and moderate your desires, then everything you can accomplish when you do that. Basically, when you focus on Wu Wei, the art of non-action. So, and at that point, you're pretty much embracing the flow of life instead of putting effort to achieve a desired result. And that's why Dr. Dyer named this chapter Living Contentment. So today I will put in front of you my translation, both translations, so you can see where I'm going with this. Everybody, can you see the translation? Living Contentment. This translation, one side is Theresa Sun and the one side is Dr. Dyer. And I have divided into three sections, and then there are phrases we will talk about, so I will point out as we move forward. But I will read in a manner where it makes sense and in easy English, because both translations are really good. So I'm going to start with the first paragraph here between Dr. Dyer and Theresa Sun. The first paragraph says that by not putting a value on a status, people will not fall into dispute. By not valuing the hard to get objects over valuing possessions, people will not steal. By not seeing what is desirable, one's heart will not be confused. So that is the first paragraph. Now we're going to talk about each line individually. So the first line, as it's saying, by not glorifying the achiever, people will not fall into dispute. Why is that? Why should we not encourage that, you know, greater achievements? It's not the direct, not, you know, encouraging someone's achievement. It is when you overdo it. So you create this competition, this division, which leads to jealousy and hate. You have noticed that, you know, at home, when you do that, you create conflict among siblings, even between your spouse and your parents. That is very common. It can also break the team at workplace, create this employee conflict. So what Lao Tzu is saying here is, he is not saying not to encourage positive behavior or achievements. We should have that as our personal goal, but he's simply saying that in society in general, don't overdo it. Don't put them people on the pedestal, because by doing so, you're creating this negative or equal or opposite. A very negative reaction to that, because everybody wants to be on the pedestal now. And at the end, you could create rather unhealthy environment. So the basic concept here is when you go overboard in highlighting certain people for praise, you begin to separate and divide people, battling each other. And at that point, people forget the original intent of this competition. It needs to be healthy so we can, you know, outdo one another for a higher purpose. But with the competition, people will try to undermine each other and will do anything possible to win. So Lao Tzu is saying that don't do that to keep the positive effect, which is people working together towards a common purpose peacefully. Unfortunately, in Asia where I grew up, and you guys probably will be able to relate to it from Asia, that we have this ranking system, especially in academic. So you have a rank of first, second, third, and then the rest of the people are pretty much losers at that point if you didn't get to the first, second, third. And along with that winner and loser mentality, living in the United States, what I found, there are two more extremes. And the first one is that either you're the winner or I'm the winner, and the other party is a loser. And number two, which is the worst, is that everybody gets the participation trophy. So that is not the great Tao. That is not the way of Tao. The ideal and Tao mentality is a win-win mentality. In order for me to win, you don't have to lose. And you should also have a sense of achievement when you earn your winnings. So, which is not same as the participation trophy. So Tao cultivator turn any and all situation positive with a win-win mindset. they use phrases like this in any conflict or any situation. Let's talk through it. Let's find a way where no one needs to lose. Let's work it out. That is great, though. The next line talks about by not valuing the hard to get objects, people will not steal. So we just talked about the valuing people over the top, and now Lao Tzu is talking about what happens when you value things, material object, in the same manner. Goods that they are hard to or difficult to obtain. In reality, we as human beings put value on things. For example, you know, gold is rare, diamonds are precious, and they are very expensive in marketplace in exchange for our hard-earned money. And personally, the way I look at them is nothing but metal and rocks. So who really made them expensive? People who overvalue them. You know, forget about the gold and the diamond. Sometimes when you put value on things, they don't need to be even big. Only because we value them so much, they become hard to get. How many people here remember last year's toilet paper chaos? I mean, simple things. When we value them too much, that's where we go wrong. People were physically hurting one another on toilet paper last year at this time. So it is basically economics 101, basis of supply and demand in a way. You reduce the supply and you increase the demand. So when we value certain things too much, we give rise to greed. And people begin plotting, scheming to acquire more of them then, because we're putting so much value to it. And people will do whatever it will take to get it. So when that happened, it started to, from the small crimes to big scams and fraud. People are legitimately running business based on fraud. I mean, there are scammers everywhere, especially the world that we live in information technology and information world era. You get this one email and you click on this link and you're pretty much doomed. I mean, they create the situation, such an urgent situation or the greed that you rush into reacting and you click on it. I mean, it can be any other situation too, where you actually start to communicate with them, not knowing who you're communicating with. So these scammers literally gave birth to cybersecurity, but that's not even enough. These scammers are getting smarter and very creative at what they do. And I have a few of my personal examples that I was this close to getting a scam network. And there were millions of dollars were involved in it. But somehow I knew, somehow something clicked and I didn't do it. So if you think about it, the genesis of all that negativity, it comes from the desires and our greed. These cyber criminals, they know the human nature, so they exploit greed. They're always fishing. They're always on a fishing expedition. You get these messages, you know, click here to get $50 Amazon gift card. Or I've been getting those text messages lately a lot that, you know, here's the link. We were unable to deliver your package. Click here for more information. So they make it so appealing that you feel like it is real. But on the other side, if we are not in control by our greed, and when we do the opposite, don't value what they are saying, and we are living with the mentality of Tao, hey, this, I was not expecting a package, so what are they talking about? Instead of saying, oh, they probably wanted to deliver someone else's package to me. So if that greed is there, you know, there will be scammers. But if you don't do it, not only you won't be the next victim to these scammers, but they will start to disappear eventually because there is nothing to fish. So without everyone, if we all have that abundant mentality, means there is plenty for all of us. When there is plenty to all of us, then, you know, we won't have that greed. And the life would be rather plain, simple and dull without greed. The next line talks about, by not seeing the desires of lust, one's heart will not be confused. So desires, desirable things or objects. Now, this is different than goods that are hard to obtain, that what we just talked about, because you can have desirable things that they are not too difficult to get. But may take you a lot of time and effort to accumulate a sufficient amount to fulfill those desires. So the difference would be that, you know, either having enough money to live comfortably versus having a desire to live a luxurious life. And for that, you need to put much more effort into it. End of the day, greed will still be the prominent factor for these kind of desires. So the bottom line is that you will want something more than what you really need. So when we talked about mundane, this is exactly what mundane looks like, worldly desires, and running after them day and day over obsessions. They turn into obsessions. So whatever these things may be, the desire for them, attachment to them has a way to messing up with our heart and our mind. And that's what he's talking about, getting confused. So when you look at the desire, when you're desirable things, you get distracted and you get off the great path of great Tao. But as a Tao cultivator, if you're truly a Tao cultivator and you're aware, you know how to perceive when you're looking at these, you know, worldly desires. The Tao cultivators, you know, they, when they're aware of these things, they live simple life. And they can see things clearly. They can see the difference between the wants and the needs. They don't get influenced by the things. The mind, they keep in mind their fundamental needs. So they don't get confused the way that Lao Tzu is talking about, because they are not influenced by these things. So basically, they know the value of money in regards to what money can buy. And they are also aware of that, you know, money can't buy everything. So, you know, if you know that difference, then you're on the path, on the right path. For example, if you truly understand the difference between money, what money can buy and money can't, the example would be, you know, money can buy you a luxurious bed, a very comfortable mattress, but it can't buy you a good night's sleep. Money can buy you a, you know, beautiful house, but money cannot buy you a home. Home is where your heart is, where you know, find peace. Money can buy you a book, but it cannot give you that wisdom. You can have a lot of social connections, but you cannot buy a friend. So you get the idea. So that is how the cultivator sees clearly the difference between the fundamental values and principles, and is not confused by the standard of one, what money can buy. So Tao cultivator knows that what holds value versus these worldly desires that Lao Tzu is talking about. The second paragraph here is talking about, let's read that. I think I'm sorry, I think on the, Okay. I'm mixing two different translations here. So the second paragraph, Dr. Dyer is saying here, the sage governs by emptying mind and heart, and by weakening one's worldly ambitions and strengthening bonds. So the more literal meaning of right here, the phrase that Lao Tzu is using, it means fills their bellies. And Teresa Soon kind of translated into substantiate one's virtue. And Dr. Dyer actually completely missed the translation for that. But it's basically, it means that taking care of the bare necessities of life that we talked about earlier too. And strengthening bones. Here is Teresa Soon is talking about strengthening one's essence. And he is using the literal word bone. That is what the word here is. It's what is reference to is the expression that we use, having the backbone, a person's strength of character. So that's what it really means. So the sage empty their mind and heart, and they weaken their worldly desires, ambitions, and they strengthening their character, their virtues. So that's what the meaning of this paragraph is. So when Lao Tzu talks about, whenever he uses the word sage, remember when it comes to the Tao Te Ching, whenever there is a reference to royalty, ruler, emperor, king, that always has another layer of meaning that is basically is talking about you. You are the ruler of the life, and you should govern your life like a sage. So when so feel free to apply anything that we're going to talk about, kingdom, ruler, or leader going forward, personally on yourself, so you can understand the concept where Lao Tzu is coming from. We all know one thing for sure, that you know, the good results in one's life, they don't just happen. They come about due to the skillful applications of Tao, being on the great path. And Tao Te Ching is full of those applications, examples of practicing Tao. And there is a direct correlation between how a wise emperor would rule and how you should run your life. And this paragraph is a perfect example of those applications and practices. Emptying one's mind. That reference to what we just talked about in the last paragraph about desirable things messing up with one's heart and getting us all confused. And so the way you handle that is kind of a those internal chaoses is the emptying your mind from the attachments and desires. And it is, you know, it is okay to have wants and desires in life, but when they go overboard, they become attachments, obsessions, and then they create a problem for us. So keep your heart empty of desires and just have the basic needs in life. And I am talking about the bare necessities here. So I am going to play a 1 minute song for you guys. Listen to the lyrics carefully. And I promise you it's just a 1 minute song. Can you guys see the screen?
Yes.
Yes. All you gotta do is all the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your stress. I mean the bare necessities, all Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life. So just try and relax. Yeah, cool it. Fall apart in my backyard. Because let me tell you something, little britches. If you act like that bee acts, you're working too hard. And don't spend your time looking around for something you want that can't be found. When you find out you can live without it and go along not thinking about it, I'll tell you something true. The bare necessities of life will come to you.
Okay. How many people remember that song from their childhood? I don't know if it's just me or I think that song is full of Tao teachings. If you never paid attention to this song before, I would highly encourage you to look at the lyrics and what he's talking about. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that also because it reflects what Lao Tzu is saying in this chapter. So the lyrics are going like this. Look for the bare necessities, the one that I just mentioned. The simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities, old Mother Nature's recipes that brings the bare necessities of life. I mean the bare necessities, that's why a bear can rest at ease with just the bare necessities of life. And at the end he said, and don't spend your time looking around for things you want that can't be found. When you find out you can live without it and go along not thinking about it, I'll tell you something true. The bare necessities of life will come to you. That is exactly what Lao Tzu's message is, not only in this chapter, but throughout the Tao Te Ching. Live simple life. And when you do that, your life will be free of strife. In Tao, there is no strife. There is no struggle. Everything is smooth and graceful. Fun, easy life. And with that carefree life, you can rest at ease, just like Baloo the bear. So when you're living accordance with the old Mother Nature's recipe, accordance with Tao, accepting life as it is, you are at ease all the time. When you stop chasing the hard to get things, and when you realize that you can live without them, the bare necessities of life, they come to you. Any comments on that?
I've got an amusing story.
Okay.
You know, everybody knows I buy and sell things, antiques, paintings and stuff like that. And I've had a couple of times over the 20 some years of doing this, people coming into my booth and seeing something, they go, oh my gosh, I've been looking for that for 15 years. And so they talk about it, why they were looking for it. Their, you know, some relative or friend had it. And for some reason, they never acquired it where they thought they would inherit it or whatever. So they were always looking for it in their hunt at going to all these antique shows and things like that. And here it is right there in front of them. And they start talking about it. And then I say, well, it's available. Would you like to buy it? And they go, how much is it? And you tell them, and they go, oh no, I'm going to keep looking. Now, I don't think it's contrary to living the bare necessities. I think it reinforces it. Here they are. They're satisfied that they've found it, but they are wise enough, and it's really not the price. They're wise enough to realize that they don't really want it. It was the journey that they were on that was the most important. And to me, that's a very positive thing. That actually, to me, speaks very loud of this living contentment, because they know it was just the hunt. And yeah, I'm going to keep looking. You know, maybe I'll find it again. But likely they won't. But that's not what matters. Mm-hmm. They're contented and just happy to be able to look, hunt, and share it with somebody. They always had people with them too, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, this is a very powerful verse.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I can remember being in India, and one of the ladies in the office was talking to me about the fact that her husband was a professor, I might add, and she was the assistant to the president of the division. And she was telling me about their desire to have a house that wasn't 2.5 hours away one way by train from Mumbai. And their desire was to have a house that was maybe half the distance, and that it would have its own source of water rather than having to carry the water from wherever to their house. And I said, oh, what kind of house do you have? And she was very proud to say, well, it was stones stacked mm-hmm. with a timber roof and a tin covering on the outside. A very proper house is her words that she used. But their desire was, and they were working very hard to get it more convenient to where they worked and to have water.
Mm-hmm. As I said earlier, house is where your heart is, where the peace is. It's not, you know, you can buy a bungalow, but if you're not happy, that's not gonna do it.
Yeah, but I took it that she was happy, but they did have this dream, I guess. Maybe a dream or a desire is the proper way. But to me, mm-hmm. it was being able to commute, like all of us. We think, oh, well, if it's a 20-minute commute rather than an hour and a half, you know, mm-hmm. that's cool.
Yeah, yeah.
To have water in the house appeared to me to be the biggest desire, you know, that they could just turn on that spigot, you know. Mm-hmm. And I paid my water bill today, and it was $20.60 for the month.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so happy to write that check because I realize how valuable water is. And for $20, what does that provide you with? You know?
Yeah.
It's a given, not a desire, right?
Yeah, but I see when I'm talking about the song, The Bare Necessities, I am not really downplaying the importance of material side of life either. Because in reality, you know, the Tao, there is no difference between the Tao and the success, because success is usually attached to wealth. And people think if you have wealth, you're wealthy, you're rich, then you must be complete and you're happy, or you should be happy. But the Tao is the integration of that success, because as you're going up on your ladder, the Tao cultivator is always content. So wherever that stage of life they are, as they are accumulating material resources for their self and their family, every step of the way, they will be grateful and they will be content. So the more they gain, they try to even contribute to the society. So that is a mindset of a person like you talked about. That is, you know, that I would not call coming water from a tap is a desire. It is a bare necessity in a way, but that's for her. She's grateful, and we take those kind of things granted because we are living in that society that everyone taking those things granted. But the emphasis of Tao cultivator is very clear. Basically, what he is saying, a big no-no to excessive attachments and materialism, because they can easily get too much and then can easily overwhelm you. And a definite yes to the basics of life and the working on strengthening your bones, your integrity, and your character. And that's what Lao Tzu is saying here. Focus on those things. The last paragraph here we're going to talk about is, I'm going to start the first two lines. It says, he lets the people to be innocent of worldly knowledge and desires. So right here, the word innocent, right here is Wuji. I don't know if I pronounced it correctly, but it's, I know it, there's Wu and then Ji. That is not same as ignorant, and is sort of like innocent. But basically what he is saying, that let the people not use their worldly sharp knowledge, their intelligent, to harm and hurt each other. And then they will be battling. So their misuse of information. And if you, in result, you won't have wuji, the excess desires for material, the things that money can buy. So the to reduce those desires, turn your focus on something more important, things in life that money cannot buy, the one I just mentioned, your integrity and your virtues. Focus on those things and don't misuse your worldly knowledge and stay innocent. The next line says that, and keep the clever ones from making trouble with their wits. Now, this line is referencing to the people we just talked about. They are scheming and plotting the root of their negative actions. So they're using their positive skills towards negative actions. And their mindset is something like that. Hey, I am smart. These people are dumb, so I'm going to cheat them. They don't deserve all the money they're sitting on. I'm going to just trick them take all that money using my scheme, my intelligence, and because I am smart. So there's an ego in that mindset of the cheater, and somehow they have that perfect justification for their not negative actions too. And then there is a greed. That is the sum of these two lines. Now, the next line, one of the better known phrase of Tao Te Ching and my personal favorite, I think you guys already guess what it is. It is Wei Wu Wei. That can be translated as act without action. Now, this action doesn't mean here any simple action, but a specific kind of action, the kind with the attachments, desires, and obsessions. So when Lao Tzu saying here, act naturally without desires, he means your actions should not be influenced by the attachment to your desires. Like Dr. Dyer actually saying here on page number 15, he said, trusting in Tao is the way to be directed by the source of your creation, and to be guided by a higher principle than your ego-driven desires. Then everything will be accomplished in its natural order. That means there is nothing we cannot do, manage, and govern when you let nature play its course. There is nothing will be beyond control. Here, Lao Tzu is describing of a Tao cultivator who is quite capable and powerful by mastering the art of getting things done without ever getting hung up on them. Does anyone want to make any comment? I hear. Okay, maybe not. Okay, so as long as you're practicing Wu Wei, nothing will remain undone. And Dr. Dyer also used the phrase or saying from Shakyamuni Buddha on page number 16, that it's very famous saying that there is no way to happiness. Happiness is the way. So the meaning of that is that you are not content because you have everything. You have everything because you are content. So that was the chapter number 3. I'm going to move on to chapter 62. We have 28 minutes left, unless someone wants to make more any comment for chapter number 3. Okay, so I'm going to switch my translation to chapter number 62. Okay. Chapter number 62. I hope you can see it properly. Okay. So here we have three sections as well. and we are going to cover them as they are here. So first, I'm going to read the first three lines. Tao is the world of all creations. It is a treasure for those who are kind. It can also protect those who are not kind. So in this section, notice yin and yang there. It starts out talking about how Tao is the wonder of all things, and it can have positive manifestations for the good people, skillful people, people who follow Tao, but also is something that can inspire and improve people who aren't so skillful and aren't so good at following Tao. So there are subtleties about Tao that, you know, we barely understand, but whenever we glimpse at them, we can use them in life to great effectiveness. You know, just like Tao cultivator, they take their cue, their hints from the nature. So what he's saying in this paragraph, that Tao cultivator, they notice that, you know, how rain falls on beautiful flowers as much as it falls on the weeds, the sunshine on the good and the wicked in the same way without discrimination. Since nature does not pick and choose based on what is accepted as good and bad, as a result, Tao, a true Tao cultivator, are compassionate to even who are not deserving. Therefore, who are good, skillful in life, they know that they should hold on to this treasure of Tao and hold on to this treasure of Tao. I'm sorry. So the next line here is words of Tao can benefit all people. Because words, they matter. Positive words can be uplifting and inspiring. And they range from, you know, inspiring historical speeches to, you know, everyday words of encouragement and even, you know, cheerful greetings. And actions can guide people to follow the right way. Because actions speak louder than words. The primary goal, the primary method of teaching of sages is not delivering lectures, but setting examples. So sages use both tools, words and actions. So that is the positive approach when you have beautiful words and beautiful actions. These are the positive ways to inspire people, to improve people. And then it says, those who have gone astray, the all-forgiving Tao will not abandon them. Because not everyone is adept with Tao. Many people are ignorant of Tao in a way that they are not receptive to it. A common example would be if the people who live, they have not lived their life to their full potential. Or extreme example would be those who have completely messed up their lives. But in these both examples, you can see it's happening to them because they are not living Tao, and that is the result they are getting. Nonetheless, those who are unkind or those who are not on the simple path, they will not be abandoned by Tao. They will still benefit from everything that Tao provides. The air that we breathe, the sun that gives us warmth, the ground that we walk on, the food that we consume, the water that quenches our thirst, and so on. So that is the yin and yang here, kind or unkind, skillful and unskillful. To nature, basically, you know, everybody is a whole. There is no, nature does not see good or bad. So does the Tao cultivator, because Tao cultivator is taking cue from the nature, and Tao cultivator are like Tao in treating people equally. And so that was this paragraph was talking about. The next paragraph right here, is basically, I'm going to read that, and it's very simple here, and people that has Chinese Asian history, they pretty much understand. It's very straightforward. It says, therefore, it is better to embrace this precious Tao than to be crowned as kings or appointed as ministers or to possess wealth and fine horses. So this section is the comparison between the Tao to the greatest spectacle in the ancient times, which was the crowning ceremony of the emperor. So the examples are given here, the three ministers, the jade, the horses, these are all the part of that ceremony. So this is nothing but a description of a spectacular event that they, you know, consider it the best what they can talk about. But as grand as it was, it is still tied to material world. For example, jade, that is the symbol of power, will break and will be stolen. The horses is given, they offer to the emperor, they will grow old and wither and die. So everything that is related to the ceremony are, despite being the greatest value in Asian time, were all material things that come and go, and they don't last. So this tangible material things, no matter how great the value, cannot compare to the intangible, immaterial, simple Tao. So this is your homework now to think about that, why Lao Tzu is saying that, why we cannot compare these material thing, these luxurious things with Tao. So I will share a couple of my examples, but it's definitely something to ponder and think and make your own list, because it's good to have some reasons. You know, just saying Tao is good sometimes is not enough. If you put it down, it might help you to understand it more. So I'll share a couple of my thoughts on it. The first one is that Tao brings the genuine happiness. That's why I cannot compare to material things, because material things, they appear, their appearance is about happiness, but they cannot guarantee true happiness. And that is exactly what we talked about earlier in chapter 3, things that money can buy and the things that money cannot buy. Number 2, Tao is everlasting and therefore it is real. Material things are temporary and deceptive. Internally, number 3, internally, Tao is about a quest for enlightenment, peace, understanding, and contentment. Material things are exactly opposite. They are the lack of contentment and desires. And number 4, externally, Tao is about creating connections with the living beings that we can relate to, the connections that we have with one another. That is precious Tao. Material things are all about accumulating more and more riches and wealth. So these are some of the reasons that, you know, we cannot compare Tao with material things. But I would say, please think about it, what you think they should be. And because Tao is literally, it's beyond value. You know, Tao is priceless. Now, what I just said, it is not a statement that should be said, but something that we should feel, something that we should regard as a supreme reality. And that's another thing I'm going to talk about, is that why I am saying that Tao is priceless. What are some ways that when we glimpse at things in nature and we value, that gives us the value of Tao. So that's number 2 part of your homework, to think about what makes it so priceless for you. Everybody will have their own list. It can be specific about something. But I'm going to give you a couple of my examples. So, and they should be simple, because Tao is simple. So when you notice and appreciate, you know, cool little things in life, think on that. Like Brother Roger was talking about, you know, the flowers blooming, the crisp sunshine after the rain, right? Clean linens, you know, clean bed sheets that you just want to crawl under. You know, how about my back is itchy and I happen to have the back scratcher here. That is pretty cool right there. But none of that is thou. But the human mind not taking these little things granted, that notices them, that appreciates them, that feels gratitude, that is thou. That is the mind that feel the gratitude for the little things and not taking these things granted. Or, you know, when you experience a epiphany, that light bulb just goes on. You know, you suddenly can see something that you couldn't see before, that puzzle, the piece of puzzle, a puzzle of life. You know, how cool is that? That consciousness that created that thought and made it part of you, that is Tao. That's the value of Tao. And when you make a mutual enriching connection with someone that understands you, that connection, that ability to make that connection, that enjoyment of the connection, that is Tao. That is the value of Tao beyond priceless. And when you help someone in need and it makes a difference, when that person looks back at you with the eyes of gratitude, let you know what you have done really made a difference. Wow, that is Tao right there. And if you wanted to have even simpler examples, just to spend time with kids and animals or both, you will feel Tao in those interactions. And even if you don't have these external activities, and just have time on your own for yourself as you see fit, there is value right there. That is Tao. And my list is not inclusive. There are many examples of how can, you know, how we can glimpse Tao in everyday life. And I just hope that you actually take time to work on it and see the life around you every moment, every day, and discover the value, discover Tao, and value yourself. That is your homework for today, number two. So now we are going to move forward to the next paragraph. And it says that, it starts by saying, why did the ancient value the and honor this Tao? Well, they treasure it for all the reasons I just mentioned and much more. We are fortunate to live in this world where rewards, you know, our efforts, we get results for them eventually. Our efforts are rewarded. Think about the way, you know, the reality is the way we exist, how we live. We are able to live in such a way that we have opportunities, we make goals, we can go after things that are meaningful for us. So basically saying that which we seek will obtain right there in this line, that which we will putting the effort to acquire that golden nugget of wisdom, that piece of knowledge, eventually we will obtain. But to reach these goals, we always talk about at the temple, we got to have discipline, consistency, persistence, perseverance, and we have to stick to that plan. As long as we keep following the right path, Tao guarantees we will get to the destination. And when I say that, I just mean, well, that is the nature of the path. If you follow the path, you will get there where it leads. So you wanted to take the path that leads to where you wanted to go. And those who offended will be forgiven. Now, forgiven doesn't mean that thou, a practitioner, can get away with crime. what it means that in this context, that getting to the destination, because it is all about that journey, it's all about the following the path in life. So it is important, very important, to pick and choose the right path, but then it is equally important to follow it to the end. So if you wear off, he's talking about the forgiven people, if they wear off and they are not on the right path, or they're not even moving, all it means that you won't get where you wanted to go. That's just the way of the Tao, period. There is no blame, there is no fault, because you alone suffer the consequences, whatever that might be, not getting to the destination that you were hoping for. Because Tao is not a personified deity. It is just a path. The road is not going to get mad at you for not taking it. It doesn't feel sad for you. It doesn't point an accusing finger at you. But ultimately, it is on you and you alone. And this last line says, thus, it is the greatest honor in the world. Absolutely, it is. Because walking the path Tao means you have to take the ultimate responsibility of yourself. In other words, Tao is such that you are the absolute ruler of your life. That is your own little empire. Except when the ceremony ends, it doesn't go away. It is only the beginning. So having this responsibility to call the shots, but some people rather have not have this responsibility. They are not sure what to do with themselves. They prefer to be told, what to do. But that is not the Tao paradigm. Tao paradigm is that you are ultimately in charge. And quite frankly, I find it liberating and very fulfilling. So did the ancient sages. They found it exciting. Hey, I can actually determine my own destiny. I mean, here I am starting off on a path, and it is my call how many steps I take on this path. I'm the only one who can make that decision. And I personally think it's very cool that you are in charge, how many steps you take, and that's what you get, how much effort you put in your lives. So when you learn to see the Tao just like the sages did, you will understand why it is such a gift to have Tao and know Tao and able to use Tao. So that is a nutshell, the essence of chapter number 62. I do have a conclusion, but I have 10 minutes. If someone wants to make a comment, quick comment, that will be welcome. Or should I move on to conclusion? Okay, no comments. Chapter 3, we're going to go back and recap now. So basically, chapter 3 had three main ideas it starts with, this is just a recap. We already talked about all of those things. So whenever desire becomes obsession in the world, whether it is among people or within yourself, that creates the problems and troubles. So in order to avoid those problems and the idea is to moderate your desires, moderate the cause to reduce the symptoms. And the three main things that this chapter covered was that, number one, gotta strike the right balance. Encourage excellence without overdoing it. So by doing so, you prevent unnecessary fights or contests, greeds, and hate. And number two, the part of the first one is that recognize the material wealth. This is very important. Recognize the material wealth as it is. What is it? A measure of your contribution, the effort that you put in. So you can be wealthy without being enslaved by your wealth. If you know this, that wealth is just the measurement of my contribution. And number two point that this chapter made is that turn to the right focus, just like the sages. So reduce your temptations, your distractions. Remember, there are more important things in life. The things that, you know, money cannot buy. That is your integrity, your virtues, and your peace of mind. And then mind your fundamental needs, basic safety and comfort, human connections, and so on. The bottom line was there is that living well, living large, living in luxury doesn't mean anything if you cannot live with yourself. And the third point was that when you want something too badly, you trip over yourself and lose what you are wishing to grasp. And pull back, detach and moderate your desires. And learn the truth about abundance, which means that there is plenty for everyone and Tao is infinite. Dr. Dyer talked about here in his book on page number 17, and he put it so beautifully, and I'm going to read that, what he said. He said, trust the perfection of the eternal Tao. The Tao is working for you and with you. So you don't need to remind it of what you crave. Trust the harmony of Tao. It took care of everything that you needed in your creation, and will continue to do so if you just trust it and practice Wu Wei. And the summary of chapter 62 further told us how Tao is the treasure house, as the source of everything and source for everything. So it's abundant. There is no greater treasure than spiritual liberation. The value of Tao is reflected in the gift of spiritual liberation, the treasure of the kind, the protection of the unkind, and it doesn't abandon anyone. Those who follow Great Tao will get to their destination, the place there they wanted to go. The destination could be joy, happiness, or perhaps peace of mind. Whatever that is, you will get there if you follow the proper path. Those who get distracted, we are off the path, or don't even take the first step and they're not moving, just sitting, they may fall behind due to their own doing. But the path is available to them as much as it's available to people who actually follow. So Tao is the value beyond value, the priceless price, the greatest wonder of the world, literally the greatest gift and the treasure house. That was my talk for these two chapters. I hope I try to cover both chapters as they were intended. If I have misspoken and said something incorrectly, I ask heaven's forgiveness and mercy from Lao Tzu himself. Now I'll turn over to moderator for any feedback or if anybody wanted to make any comments. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Anna. I do ask, I want to reiterate the fact that if anybody has anything they'd like to offer, that would be appreciated. We can only offer, I know, oportunidad, as we say in Latin America, is very important. And I think this lesson talks about that. The opportunity is if we realize that it's really our opportunity to be contented. Charles, did you want to say something? Charles, are you there? Ah, Okay. A couple of weeks ago, we were talking here before class. We were talking about, I think it was Barbara that brought up the word be, you know, beginning and end, being, you know, is contained within that word, the beginning and the end, being or be. And that to me is something that contentment is something that had taken me a long time to appreciate. Someone mentioned to me today the fact that, you know, we have this driving force inside of us, you know, in quote unquote business. And I said to her, well, you don't really give the appearance of that. You seem very well balanced. You're there serving. And she says, oh, well, that I converted that challenge I had of being the best at doing this and the best at doing that for a sale when I realized I just needed to do the best for the customer and what the customer needed. And I had given her something that I eventually will share with you. I have a 60,000-year-old cave bear incisor that I had her make into a drop for a chain. And I don't know why I've had this affinity with this particular collection of cave bear things that I traded for somebody and sold off all except for this one incisor a year or two ago. Well, anyway, there were nothing but problems associated with getting this thing mounted correctly, getting it properly made to the picture I had drawn and how I wanted it. And she kept apologizing. And I said, for what? I said, you did it this way. Maybe I didn't convey it enough. You know, it's been a year and a half. We've had problems with COVID and material compatibility and orientation in terms of the design of it. But it's all good. And she said, oh, you feel happy. I said, I'm happy to finally have it. And I said, what do I owe you? And she said, and gave me a number. And I paid her and I said, is that enough? She said, it's all that I need because you are happy. I said, are you making any money? And she goes, no, but you're contented and you're a customer, but you're a friend and a dealer as well. And she said, I'm happy that I was able to get this done for you in the way that you wanted. And to me, I didn't feel that I was buying any service or I was trading for any service or anything like that. But I did feel that she was giving me a gift. And rather than it being supplying something to somebody that they don't need or appreciate or care about, she was allowing me to realize not only the continued connection I had with that piece, but the value that she attributed to it so that I could benefit and appreciate it for the value that it had. I don't know what that value is. Someone said to me, why do you like that? I said, because, you know, maybe at one time I hunted that Siberian cave bear and maybe wounded it. And when it died 60,000 years ago in that cave in Siberia, maybe that was the connection that I had with it. And I kind of laughed, but in reality, do we really know that or not? But if we have a connection with it, somebody said to me, oh, that's a bear's tooth, isn't it? I go, yeah. And the person said to me, do you have a permit for that? I said, what do you mean? Well, a hunting permit that it was harvested properly. I said, well, I don't think they had writing back then. And the person said, what do you mean? I said, it's 60,000 years old. If you'd like me to show you the The client I got it from, who has the papers on it, I can show you that it's 60,000 or 50, pardon me, 50,000 years old. I said, I don't think there was such a thing as government or a permit or anything at that particular time. Was there? And it turned out this was, you know, some sort of ranger or something or other, the person, that, and he just moved on, didn't say anything about it. But the fact is, he didn't appreciate it. He didn't understand it. But Kathy Lee understood it and appreciated it. She was contented. And she is a good example of a cultivator who hasn't quite yet received the blessing, but is certainly a cultivator in all, everything that Lao Tzu is talking about, because she's contented. And she's providing a service. I will say that chapter three, I think you gave a great summary of both 3 and 62. And I just want to touch on very briefly. I think the three elements of 3 in particular are very important, because I think they're really talking about governing the world. And Lao Tzu was trying to show people to first sever all your evil intentions and bad thoughts. And this was the only way to maintain a great vitality and energy. And I believe by energy, I'm talking about Tao energy or spirit or light. Saints also, or he also talked about, when we do that, we eliminate the pride and conceit and their competitive nature to employ bad practices just to succeed. We've always heard the comment, I'll do anything to succeed. I'll do anything to get out ahead of the game, to get a fancy car, to get a big house. You know, that kind of focus will never be the focus of being content. And the third point is, Lao Tzu emphasizes the importance of the fact that, you know, if you're contented, that you'll have good health and stamina. You know, contentment can, in our terms, at this time, can be mental health or satisfaction, or as we've talked about here in the past, being contented in your own skin. You know, not trying to be somebody else, but just being happy being there, you know, back to that word be. And how many times have we seen people drive themselves so hard? And I have to tell you, 35 years ago, I was driving myself so hard, I got double pneumonia and it almost killed me. I only had a couple hours, according to the doctors, to live. And I've mentioned it before, and if it wasn't because of my wife's perseverance and getting the chief doctor of the department, I would have probably died 35 years ago. But it was that drive of corporate world, being a scoutmaster, being an environmentalist, and doing all these things and not being happy or contented with the benefit that I had and the really success and love that I had with my family and with what I was doing. It just became an obsession. So yeah, it can affect your health and your stamina. So everybody needs to realize that by being this, having this contentment, you know, you can achieve purity, peace, and harmony without conceit and desire. And you'll be at peace, but you also will be extremely successful in no matter what you do. I don't know if that is clear what I'm trying to say, but what I'm trying to say is the opportunities, the positive things that you're looking for and trying to achieve, sometimes we put our own barriers in front of us and we have to do all kinds of things to drive through them. But the point is, if we don't put those barriers up, Tao gives us the opportunity to see the path and open the path to us so that we can be successful. And by successful to me, it means being able to cultivate more and being more service and happier. So if everybody would think about those three things, and I'm talking about everybody in the world, I don't see that the world would have 90% of the problems that we have right now. You know, we talked about a woman issue earlier today in the Middle East. Well, there's, you know, difficulties with women here and everywhere else. There's difficulties with men and women in the world as well. There's differences, but I think the key, and we've talked about it in many times before, the greatness of this class is that we tend to talk about the sameness and the affinity and the fact that, you know, we're all children of God, we're all gods, we're all Buddhas, we're all on the path. And if more and more people came to that realization, I think the world would be in a much better state rather than constantly looking at the differences. We even talked about that a little earlier, saying how everybody seems to focus on differences more than the common and the greatness that we all have. So that's a little bit more than I wanted to do to talk about three, but the last thing I want to mention is 62. I'm just going to make one comment, and that is a nodal, and Aaron brought it up, and I think it was very clear, but I'd like to reiterate it. A noble person regards cultivation as the most precious of all things. Even though an unkind person may not cultivate themselves, they still rely on Tao for protection. And, you know, it's truth. You know, I think it was Master had talked a couple of weeks ago about the fact that, you know, we tend to look at a positive things and we look at negative things. Well, we need to look at the whole thing. And you know, what may be a negative for you can truly be a positive for me. And what can be a positive thing for you may be clearly a negative thing for me. But the fact is, if we look at the whole, there's benefit in it for us both. Because a perfect example is my wife and I. You know, people have always said, oh, Nancy is so different than you and you're so different than her. How does it work? Well, it works, I believe, for us because we're so darn different. And after 46 years of marriage, we're still different, but we're still the same. And yeah, sometimes she tends to bite her tongue more than I do. And then sometimes she reminds me that I need to bite my tongue more than I do. But that works. And I think this lesson talks about the Tao as being that valued treasure. And I think if it's even more valued, if you can share it with somebody. And I consider this class value to me because I feel I'm learning from everybody else in this class. And I always say that I learn more from my customers and my interactions than I do what I know myself. So having said that, that's my summary, and these two lessons, and if Master would like to share a few moments of her time, we would all appreciate that. Thank you.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Sister Aram. Thank you, Brother Roger. I think Sister Aram covered these two chapters very well. And she actually spoke the Chinese character Wu Zi, okay? And this is same like when we're talking about, it's like the childlike heart. And it doesn't have the material desires that as we grow up, we tend to accumulate, okay? And I think Brother Roger and Sister Aram both covered that very well. The 62, chapter 62, when we're talking about why the ancients valued and honored this Tao. Well, today we're able to gather here and be here together. It's also because of Tao. It is not because of Tao, it's not because of we have this commonality with all of us. We would not be here. Right? So that's why we're so grateful. I am personally, like Sister Erin was talking about, giving us like a class assignment. I to me, Tao save lives. And not only for myself, but I also think it save family. I think Brother Roger and Sister Aram also talked about this. Save the world, okay? Save our society, because it teaches us or it brings out what's in us that is very innate within all of us to be kind, to be merciful, to be benevolent. And those are covered up by our greed for fame and fortune, and our desires for material things, and the clouds that innate Tao essence within all of us. And that's why I'm going to share with this poem about contentment it's this Chinese poem. I heard it in the study class before, and I saw it today, so I want to share with all of you. It's talking about this, like, I saw, like, you know, this person that talking about, I saw others riding on stallions, and I am riding on a mule. See how great the person that is riding the stallions, they have seen this scenic view, how they have better scenic views, and how fast they can travel, okay? And then he's like, but I look back and I saw this person pulling a cart. So this is like, it's a reflection upon ourselves. We always see like in the beginning of the class, Sister Erin was talking about how we see these worth or this value or these things that we place on there. And then we keep chasing after it. But we forgot we are having much, much more already. You know, we're much, much luckier than a lot of other people. So we are should be very grateful that we are here talking about Tao and that how to better ourselves, how we can get more people walking on the same path together to reach our common destination. And that's the purpose we have. And another thing that I feel the Tao in us is give us direction, where we want to go, how we want to live our life, give us our life meaning and value and worth. Those are not based on material things or what status you have or what prestige or what title you have, but really how much we can influence and change and save ourselves and save our people around us and save the society in the whole. And when we are doing that, I think we have this, we talk about peace, we talk about contentment, talk about serenity. That's when we really are all walking on this same path. We'll be one day going to the same destination, okay? And that realization will bring us that serenity and peace that we all talked about, hope for world peace. We during Christmas, we like to and New Year's, we like to wish for that. But as we know, if you do it throughout daily lives and influence and changes ourselves and influence others, so we hopefully and we can in our lifetime to bring that peace to this world. And that's the merciful vow of our Grandmaster Mingyue Buddha. So I hope everybody, we can continue to do so and to bring more people on this path and do not fall off on this path. We have to continue to keep walking on this path that had been shown to us by many people in front of us, who Brother Roger and I know, our Prime Master C, you know, our Elder Mama C, you know, we have Qinghui Buddhasava and also our Yuanyong Senzen, our Point Master Wang. And they have shown us that is achievable. So we have to keep our, keep our heads up and continue to plow forward. Okay? All right. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Master, for your words and your sacrifice in serving. Thank you. If everybody would please rise, I would like to